Okay, thank you. Thank you guys for coming. Sorry for the little interruption in the beginning. I'm going to be talking today about integration and microservices and cloud technologies. I promise at one point these slides did make some sense. I'm traveling from the West Coast of the United States. I'm a little bit jet lagged. I can't promise that when I tell you about them, it's going to make sense. But what we're talking about today is all related to technology, but how technology drives businesses to be more agile, or enables them to be more agile and more flexible and respond in their very demanding competitive markets. In the States, we have a market index, stock market index, called S&P 500. And over the last 100 years, the companies that make up and are part of the S&P 500, the life expectancy for those companies has been dropping quite dramatically. In 1937, the life expectancy of a company on the S&P 500 was about 75 years, and now it's closer to 15, and they say in 2026 that the entire S&P 500 will be replaced with new companies. So I travel a lot to a lot of, so I work for Red Hat, I travel a lot to different customers and talk about business agility and how technology drives that. And we run into a lot of cases where either the CIOs have read, the CIO magazines and everybody's talking about microservices and what Netflix is doing, or the technology groups have adopted Spring Boot and they're looking at Docker and trying to figure out how to do microservices. But there's a lot of challenges that are involved with implementing microservices architecture. And I do get asked quite a bit, well, if we're going to do microservices, do I need integration? Do I need X? Do I need Y? I know I need all this other stuff that everybody keeps talking about, but do I need integration? And a big part of the talk will focus on whether or not you do. And where Docker and Kubernetes and some of the open source projects that I'll be talking about, where they fit as well. So my name is Christian Posta. I'm a principal architect at Red Hat. And I recently just wrote a book called Microservices for Java Developers, and I have a couple copies here that I'll hand out for people who ask interesting questions and stay engaged. And I worked at a large internet company that is now famous for their microservices implementation. So I got to see hands-on and working with them what it really looks like. It's not all glamorous. When I first saw it, they didn't call it microservices back then; they called it SOA, and it was a little eye-opening. So now I can talk a little bit about that. I'm also a committer on some of the open source projects that are related to what we'll be talking about today. So just so that we can quickly level set and have a common understanding about what microservices is, maybe a quick show of hands, who's heard of microservices? Mostly everybody, yeah. Who's actually implementing a system that looks like microservices, or what we're describing as microservices? So when we talk about microservices, we talk about breaking otherwise large, slow-moving, slow-to-adapt, slow-to-change systems into smaller pieces, so that individually we can understand what those smaller pieces do. We can test them easier, and we can change them at the rate of the business needs. Right. So we're talking about business agility when a company is being disrupted by a startup, then they need to change. They need to change the way they do things. They need to improve customer experience. And that is being driven by technology. So we want to break these things down into smaller pieces. We want them to be autonomous because they need to be able to change independently from the other parts of the system. We want them to own their own data. We want them to be able to choose the right technology for the process of the problem that small component is trying to solve. So we want them to be potentially polyglot technology when it makes sense. We don't want to just throw in all kinds of technology just for the hell of it. We want to make smart decisions about how we solve these small problems. Now, going from a traditional company where we have hierarchy, organizational structure, we've been built from the ground up for the last 100 years to be able to do things with competitively, churn out products, 18-month planning cycles, and all this stuff. To go from that model to a more agile business that can change, where teams can make individual decisions on their own and respond quickly, that model involves more than just technology. And here are some of the challenges that that organizations are facing. One is that organizational structure. When I worked at the, it was Amazon that I worked, the way that they're structured, the teams are structured, are small individual pods. They have a term called a two-pizza team. So a team cannot be any bigger than what two pizzas can be. So they have these small autonomous teams that own the services that they implement, that they work on. And they own them to the extent that they write code, and they also do QA, and they also deploy them and operate them in production. So they have a lot of tooling built up around them to enable them to do this. And a lot of that platform is what we're starting to see in the cloud platform that we're going to be talking about today. So organizational challenges are important. How organizations are going to be able to adopt the cloud technology that everybody's talking about. Because once we start breaking things down into smaller pieces and letting teams go off and operate them, that creates a management overhead, a management nightmare. Now you have more things to deal with, more things to patch, more things to deploy quicker now, especially if we want to deploy quicker. So what we really want is to have APIs written around the infrastructure so we can automate a lot of this stuff. So how companies are changing the way teams work so that they can take advantage of automation around the infrastructure. The last piece right here quickly gets overlooked because it's not interesting, I think, to some developers. But to me, this is what makes microservices different at an enterprise than it is at an internet technology company. Like I said, this whole thing is about business agility. And each company is going to try to figure out what business agility means to them, and quite well, it will be different from what it means to other companies. So trying to copy exactly what Netflix is doing today might not be the same foundation that Netflix came from, and it might not make sense for you to copy exactly what they're doing today. To me, the domain models, how you understand what the business is doing, and how you implement that in technology, that's going to be different across companies and is going to be where a lot of the complexity is in microservices deployment. If you look at Netflix or you look at Twitter, their domain, or LinkedIn, their domain is pretty simple. You think you go to Twitter and you type a tweet in, I mean, that's that simple, the tweet. And then your followers will read tweet and all that stuff. They use microservices to solve the complexity in the scale that they are trying to reach 500 million users or whatever it is. Enterprises, their domain, the financial services industries, the health industries, insurance industries, these are domains that are very, very complex. Comparing it to a tweet doesn't even make any sense to them. So the complexity of microservices for enterprises is going to be in the domain. And it's also going to be in the scale. It might not be Amazon scale, but they're going to have scale problems. So it's the two of the things coming together, which makes it a little more challenging if you're just naively trying to copy the Netflix. And let me describe what I mean by complexity in the domain. We've been implementing systems as big monolith systems in the past. But that doesn't mean we can't modularize monolithic applications as well. But the domain that we deal with helps drive where we create those boundaries. So for example, an account for a customer, what does that really mean to some of your big complex applications? Well, I can ask, what is a book? What is a book? Can someone, it's kind of a silly question, but what, can someone explain to me, or is your man explain to me? And maybe you'll end up getting a book. What is a book? How would you describe a book? Thinking that we need to create a database or data model. So it's not just one of the books. What's that?
Depends who you are.
That's exactly right. because I could be an author. author and you know the publisher, when they report who's writing books, you might have, you know, a book might be one title that an author's written, and maybe an author has two titles, maybe they've written two books. But what if you're like Kyle Simpson here and you're writing a second edition of a book? How do you model that? Is that an attribute? Is that a sub-record? Depends on who's asking the question. If you look at a library or a book online bookstore, how do they look at books? I have two books here. Is it really two books or is it just one book? It's just one title, just two copies. Maybe a book is so big that it gets broken down into multiple volumes. Now, is that a book? Or maybe you have a lot of works that get combined into a single volume. So now, what is a book is a far more complicated question than people think. And this sort of example shows up in our domains, our financial domains, and insurance, and health, and retail, and all this stuff. And it's far more complicated than just what is a book. Who's seen this book? Nobody's seen this book before? A couple people? This book was actually written in 2002. And the premise of the book is how do we tackle that complexity in the domain? How do you make that a first-class approach to developing software by looking at what is a book, what is an account, what is a customer, and creating boundaries around these domain models so that when you ask that question, you know the context around that domain model. And that question isn't a silly question anymore. What a book means to a certain bounded context is what the Eric Evans uses in that book. You can look at it and you can make assertions about it and you know the context around it. You can have you can build a language around it, discuss it with people in business, and everybody's on the same page. You don't have this conflicting ambiguity between the different domain models. So in a real system, in real, where there's complexity in the domain, like this little example about the books, you may have a couple of different bounded contexts that each have their own domain model. A is that's the checkout part of the application. And we've broken this out into its own little boundary here. What a book means to the checkout application can be different from what it means in the reporting application or the recommendations application. And the way we model this in the database, and which databases that we do use, could be different across those different boundaries. And if you start to go back to what is a microservices definition, which you saw on the first slide, where services own their own data, they would own their own data model in this case, they could use different databases across the different data models. Maybe in the recommendations bounded context, we want to use a graph database. Maybe in the checkout bounded context, we want more transactional semantics, and we'll use a relational database. But you can start to see in any real non-trivial domain, this continues to get really, really complicated. Now, how those models and how you integrate and how you talk and actually build a business flow and business process across all these different domains is by integration. We have to have integration. And Eric Evans' book, he talks about explicit transformations. He talks about anti-corruption layers, so that the domain models in certain contexts, say pure, take on weird forms after iterations and development and so on. So we absolutely need integration between these pieces. We need integration between microservices. We need them between bounded contexts. We also need them from the standpoint that a lot of our enterprise customers are also have a lot of legacy stuff too. We can't just rebuild everything. We have legacy systems, vintages, last 30 years of some mainframes and Morba, direct client server and .NET and all kinds of stuff. Now mobile and big data and all this stuff is kind of coming together. And all of these things are still true in our enterprises. But do you need this style of integration? And I think this is where we may have gone a little sideways. I think we, big enterprises, the way they're structured, the way they think, is let's just go buy something to solve our integration problem. And let's build this big model of a team around this big thing that we bought. But the hard part of doing integration isn't buying something and putting a team together. It's what is the book? What are the differences between the domain models? Somebody actually has to do that transformation. That's the hard part. This kind of thing, you know, although it has the different technology connectors and all that stuff, you can point to where all the integrations are, can become a bottleneck, become a distraction. Maybe there's a different way. Who uses Apache Camel today? A couple people. He wrote it. Okay. So, Apache Camel is a small Java library. Let's start off with that because that's important. It's not this. Okay, it's a small Java library. And why is that important? Because now you can take this library, like you can take any library, like Log4j or something, the logging library, and you can embed it in your applications. You can deploy your applications into a Java EE server if you want, or a servlet container, or an OCI container, or anything, or no container. Docker directly if you want, or Spring Boot, Mollify Smart, something like that. And that is very well suited for microservices. When you start to break things down, you want to have flexibility in how you actually deploy your application. And Apache Camel basically brings a lot of this stuff, a lot of this functionality, being able to connect different technologies and do transformations and that kind of stuff, in the form of library. So when we talk about microservices, you don't see Apache Camel come up that often in discussions, because Camel's 9 years old. It's not the new, shiny, flashy thing. But it fits very well in a microservices environment, because it helps do the transformation in the domain model. It's very small and lightweight, runs in any kind of AVM container. And in fact, Amazon and Netflix, and probably more of the internet companies, also use Apache Camel for this kind of thing. But 9 years old, it's not as flashy. But if you look at some of the stuff that it does, and has done for a little while, it sounds like a lot of the new flashy stuff that people want to talk about. But I've actually done that for a while. Stuff like failure handling, circuit breakers. So if downstream systems are failing, you don't want to keep pounding on them. You want to open up the circuit and shed load. Things like dynamic routing, being able to make smart routing decisions on the fly inside of your microservice. Back pressure, identity consumer. Who's heard of identity consumer? It's an incredibly powerful pattern, integration pattern, or distributed systems pattern that allows your systems to be more resilient. If you think that you're going to write two-phase commit transactions across everything, across your entire distributed system, that's not going to scale. That's going to be a management nightmare. That's not really a good idea. But if you make your consumers be able to track the messages that they process, it adds a little overhead across the consumers. But if systems fail and they replay messages, you don't have to try to manage that whether or not a transaction really happened. If you're seeing duplicates, you just filter them out. Let the consumers filter out duplicates. And it's so that simple, but I never see people do it. It's so powerful. So, if you look at some of those concepts that Camel brings to the table, and you apply it to where that might fit in this idea of bounded concepts and different domain models, and the domain models help you figure out where those boundaries are and break things down into smaller pieces, Apache Camel can live within those pieces or between those pieces. It's not super opinionated about how you actually deploy it and use it, but for example, this is sort of the stuff that I've seen at the internet companies. Here's an example. If you have a legacy back end and you want to make it REST friendly, REST API, build REST APIs around it, you might have to match the integration with the legacy piece, but you want to expose the REST endpoint. Okay, so Apache Camel is perfect for this. The DSL is very expressive. Camel has about 200 or so components of problem external systems. And the syntax for using those components is identical across all of them. You don't have to be an expert in all the different ways. You might use JMS or talk to database or anything. It's just very consistent. And you can see it's a URI syntax. You specify the component, and then in this case, we're specifying a topic, the topic name, but you could be talking to a database as well. You could be talking to AWS or any cloud provider, like some roughly about 200 components in the community. And the DSL here is very expressive. You can use it and write it in Java, write it in XML, write it in Scala, grouping and so on. There's lots of different flavors for how you actually write the route. Here's an example of a circuit breaker. Who's heard of Netflix districts? A couple people. So Camel has district support. It basically says that we can talk to external systems, but we'll wrap them in this circuit breaker or bulkhead. That if that downstream system starts to fail, then no sense sending more traffic to it. We'll fall back. Right? We'll open the circuit, we'll shed load, and then we'll fall back and do something. Maybe we'll call a different service, or maybe we'll return some constant, or maybe we'll derive something based on the data that we have. And Camel has that built into DSL. The last pattern, like I said, identity consumer, where you can consume messages off the queue or a file system or anything, HTTP endpoint, and do a quick check to see, is that a message that I've already processed? And if I try to implement once and only once processing, then I'm going to filter out the duplicates. But now I don't need to have an expensive and availability limiting and scale limiting two-phase commit transaction across this system. So there's no easy answer to microservices. Apache Camel is very helpful in getting the services to be able to talk to each other. But my head still hurts because none of the other stuff about microservices is kind of addressed here. Yeah. And here are some of the problems that a developer will run into when they start to build microservices applications. And the first part of that is what happens on the developer's laptop. We talk about cloud and platforms and all this stuff, but what happens on the developer's laptop when they're building these microservices? So if you have multiple pieces that might need to go to a system, you might need to run multiple pieces on your machine. And if it's a web-based, maybe it's a couple different services that expose REST. It's likely, especially the Java services, they'll listen on port 8080 or 9090 or something like that, very common. So if you start up these applications on your laptop, they're all going to try to find the port 8080. They're not going to work. One will work. Now you can go figure out, okay, now how do I change this port to this application? Maybe it's a file system. Maybe it's both looking at the same slash temp or some location on the file system that collide. Now you can go in and figure out how to configure these applications. And that gets kind of tedious. Now, how do you test them? How do you specify configuration for them? How do you deploy them? How do you do service discovery? How do you do all these things that you want to do at runtime from your laptop, from the developer's standpoint? And this is where Linux containers and some of the technology that's coming out of Docker and Kubernetes communities, that's where those technologies fit. That's where they, even on the developer's laptop, that's they address those problems that we just saw. Everyone's heard of Docker, right? Who's heard of Kubernetes? Okay, a couple people. So Docker is the answer to a lot of prayers in some ways. With Docker, we can run multiple microservices. Okay? And the way we do that in our environment today is run a bunch of different Java processes. We're talking about Java. Run a bunch of different JVMs. Now, if we run all those JVMs on a single VM, it is possible, and it happens more often than you think, that those, one or two of those JVMs might start consuming all the CPU, for example, or blow up the network, or blow up storage, or whatever, and take down all those other services. So one approach to dealing with that is, well, let's break them all off into separate VMs. And in a lot of ways, the JVM, when it's tuned for garbage collection and all that stuff, it expect it to be the only thing running on the machine. So that makes sense, but then now you have all these VMs. These VMs have got overhead, they have operating systems, but, you know, they virtualize the devices and all that stuff. And you have to patch them, you have to take care of them, and you have to license them and all that stuff. With Docker, you can run all of those JVMs as a single process, or sorry, each JVM would run as its own process, and it can run on a single machine, but they'll be fully isolated from each other. So Docker basically uses Linux containers, which is something deep in the Linux operating system, built in, it's been there for a while, that allows you to run your microservices on the same host, but fully isolated from each other. If one of those JVMs starts to go off the table, it's isolated, it doesn't affect everybody else. The other thing that Docker allows us to do is take our application and bundle it up with all of its dependencies. So regardless of whether it's Java or Node.js or Python or whatever, it doesn't matter. You can take your application. The way we deploy applications right now is we take a war file or ear file or jar file, whatever, and we build it and run it on our machine. And then we say to operations or the deployment team, here, take this binary, take this war, and put it into the application server or into the JVM on the QA system. And we hope and pray and cross our fingers that the operating system is the same, the version of the JVM is the same, the version of the application server is the same, and a lot of times it's not. So the Docker, what we can do is take our war file, put it directly into the application server, take the JVM as well, and bundle all those things and all the JVM's dependencies and stuff. So that when we run things locally on our machine, we can package it up into this container, this opaque thing, and move it to QA. And now when we run it in QA, it's running the exact same version of the JVM and the application server and our application without trying to balance all these moving pieces. And now we take it into production, and we know that whatever we tested in QA is what's going to run. So Docker is amazing at least those two things. Now, how do you take applications that might be packaged up in this container analogy and deploy them out? Your applications are usually going to have multiple components, right? We're talking about microservices, we have multiple components working together, so there's going to be multiple types of these containers. And for each one of those, each type of those containers, you may want multiple instances of them running, because if one goes down, you want it to be able to fail over and do all that stuff. So if you start to treat the concept of an application as an opaque container, all of its stuff in it, how you deploy it, how you start and stop it, how you scale it, how you load balance against it, how you do service discovery, all these things, now, if you look at it through that one abstraction, become a lot simpler in the sense that now you can build a tool that understands that common abstraction, understands Docker, and whatever language you write your application in, doesn't matter, you get all these things. Management, start, stop, service discovery, load balance, all this stuff just baked into the system. And that's what Kubernetes is. Kubernetes was started by Google. Google has been running containers for about 10 years now. And they helped implement a lot of the founding pieces of the Linux kernel that allows people to run containers. Very experienced at it. They have their own internal container orchestration engine called Borg, and they wrote a paper about it. Google's been amazing. A lot of the complex distributed systems problems that they've solved, they've written papers about and published, and a lot of people went out and tried to implement it. And the Borg paper was the Mesos guys tried to reading that paper and implementing it, and the Cloud Foundry guys did the same thing when we were from Google and implemented it. And the Google guys were like, yeah, I'm sick of people implementing our papers. Google never actually implemented their own papers in the open source community, so that's what they did with Kubernetes. So they started Kubernetes, and by side, Red Hat, who's kind of a Linux company, as you might know, has been doing Linux container technology for a while as well. And for our third iteration of our container as a service or platform as a service, we wanted to use Docker, and we need to have a container orchestration and they said, okay, we'll just work with you. You know what you're doing. You've been doing this for a little while under Google. So now Red Hat works very closely with Google and the open source community. Red Hat is a leading contributor to Kubernetes behind Google. And this is what we're, this combination of technology, which is sort of shifting the landscape in the cloud communities, is what we're heavily invested in. We think it's the right approach. So that's what, those are the underpinnings of what Red Hat OpenShift is. OpenShift is an open source community as well, and it brings an enterprise view on top of this container and cloud technology. Google, although they're amazing, they built all this stuff, they built it with Google in mind. Enterprises are not Google. Enterprises have different constraints and needs and wants. Stuff like, for example, LDAP. LDAP is ubiquitous at enterprises. Google doesn't have an LDAP. Google doesn't really care about that. So Red Hat wrote all the LDAP. Enterprises need more audit tracking, and they need more fine-grained security and fine-grained role access control and allocate project allocation, all this stuff that Google doesn't think about, internet companies don't think, they don't care about. But our enterprise companies do, so Red Hat contributed all a lot of that stuff. So the OpenShift community is actually it's a downstream from Kubernetes, but it's also an upstream, because we take Kubernetes and build all this other stuff on top of it. But the Kubernetes community sees what we're doing, and they say, oh, that's actually released from the LDAP stuff. Let's pull that back into Kubernetes. So it's very much a co-evolution between the two open source projects, complementary to each other. So how does Camel fit into this world? In the Fabricate community, Fabricate.io, which I'll talk about in a little bit very, very quickly, and then James Strachan and James Rollins in further talks we'll go into more detail about. But in the Fabricate community, we've been all about how do we take a developer experience, like I started saying, about how we do things on our machines, how do we build and run microservices on our machines that should run the same way in a cloud platform, and the tooling and visualization, all this stuff. How do we make that experience nice for developers? So in that community, we're feeding a lot of good insight and good tooling into what we're calling at Red Hat the Fuse Integration Services for OpenShift, which basically says, here's a set of tools and some Docker images that allow you to run and build integrations locally on your machine, and then deploy them just as they're running on your machine into So things like native plugins, your Java, if you're writing Camel integrations, you're writing in sort of JVM, native plugins that plug right into your build process that allow you to build Docker containers as part of your native build. Things like the configurations and the manifests that you need to deploy into a cloud environment, the native plugin will automatically generate that. The Docker images themselves, the base images themselves, where those JVMs run, and how your application gets built and put into those Docker images, the main plugins do that for you. And then another key piece is this CDK, which is the container development kit that basically runs a full-blown OpenShift in a VM on your laptop. And now when you build your containers and build all the configuration, all the stuff generated for you by the native plugin, you just deploy it directly into a real OpenShift running on your machine. Now, that's really good. The tooling or the packaging allows you to package things as different types of JVM. So you can use an OCI container, like Apache Graph. You can use no container. Camel actually has a Camel boot mechanism baked into it that allows you to bootstrap a flat cloud scalar style application without any too much magic and without any heavy dependencies like a dependency injection container. You don't want one. Now, if you wanted to, you can use Spring, you can use CDI, you can use OpenShift Blueprint in these environments. It's up to you, depending on how you want to deploy your applications. And all of this stuff doesn't replace your existing tooling, your existing ecosystem, and like how you do builds. So you do stuff on your laptop, and now when you go into your continuous integration development or environment, and QA and DevOps or QA, QAT, and prod, and so on. And if you're using Jenkins and Maven, and that's just all these things that plug right in. So now we've kind of got some of these problems solved with the tooling from the Fabric community or these integration services. How do you run them all locally? Well, you run them in the CDK. They're going to be running as Docker containers inside of this CDK that's running locally on your machine. You make modifications to your code, you can test it locally and package it immediately, deploy it back into the CDK. And once you get things running and get things at a state where it's ready to go into a shared environment like a dev or a QA or whatever, now you have the confidence that both the containers and the configuration metadata about those containers can then be moved into higher environments. So stuff like packaging, now we use packaging as Docker. If you want to run testing and integration testing, you can use Arkillion and the Arkillion plugins for running this environment. Run everything on the CDK. Service discovery and load balancing and failover and all that stuff is handled by Kubernetes. And then if you're deploying multiple versions of your app and you need to version them and wrap security and stuff around them, you have API managers kind of built into the platform as well from an open source platform called API Manager. Are there any questions about that kind of stuff? So basically it looks like this. We're developing locally like we do today using our IDE or GNOME IDE or whatever you want to use. And you're building your applications and then you're building and packaging them as Docker containers and then you're running them inside of OpenShift or Kubernetes right on your machine. So that now you have more confidence once you take your app into higher environments that it's whatever's running here is going to be the same thing that runs over there. So this is an example of a project that I'm working on right now that's taking a traditional Java EE monolith and breaking it down into smaller pieces. And I don't have the demo that I wanted to have today to show this. It's a little bit of progress, about 90% there, but I couldn't get it done by this talk. But basically, what we're doing is we're going through the mechanics of breaking things down into the amount of context, identifying different domain models, and integrating across them in such a way that we can scale the pieces individually. We don't have to rely on two-phase commit transactions, and everything becomes eventually consistent. I'm happy to share the demos of it and the walkthrough, the mindset and the thinking through that I've been doing it. I've been publishing that stuff on my blog. But a lot of the stuff that we talked about today will be exemplified here. The demo that I will show you today is based on some of the tooling that we use, called Maven plugin tooling, building Docker images using Apache Camel. And then once you've got everything running on your laptop as a developer, how you move that stuff into that QA, I alluded to it, but the Fabricate community has built a set of tools that make up a microservices platform for being able to do that. Being able to take your applications from your machine, deploy them into dev, and then do continuous delivery with complex workflows and promotions and all kinds of different environments that you can plug into that uses Jenkins, Jenkins workflow, and Nexus, and Salesforce, and a bunch of other stuff. That when you go to the platform and use it as a developer, as a user, then you get this nice UI and you deal with all the different components that are all integrated for you. And so here's a couple screenshots that I'll try to show where an application successfully went through the delivery pipeline And we're also logging all the different metrics about how many times this thing's been deployed and how many times it's, or how long it's waited to get approvals and that kind of stuff. So it's always built in. So that's the end of the speaking part. I'll show you a quick demo. Are there any questions before we get to the demo? Any questions? Yeah.
How do you compare Apache Camel maybe instead of Spring integration or Electronic integration? So how do you choose what integration framework to use in general?
That's a good question. So to me, the difference between the two, they're both Java libraries. One's implemented Spring organization, one's Apache, the Apache Software Foundation. Apache Camel tends to have a lot more community behind it. There's a lot more components, integration components that have been built by the community and contributed by the community. At a little bit lower level, the abstraction that's being used between the two libraries is different also. In Spring integration, you have the abstraction, main abstraction with the channel. And event-driven consumers and components are all based on the channel. And you have to know about each, well, you used to, I don't know how to do it, but you used to have to know about each individual channel and what kind of channel it was and how all these things came together. And at the end of the day, your route was like, it got pretty messy because you had to keep track of all the channels. And in Camel, the abstraction is really the route itself. Channels are also being used, but they're used under the coverage, it's not the abstraction that the developers use. So that when you look at the route, it looks a lot more expressive about what the route's doing as opposed to, you know, how the route's doing.
So it's basically a little bit less modern architecture, for example.
You know, and the Spring guys may have changed it. Maybe they, you know, there's less boilerplate available to use their DSL also. I haven't used it in a lot, but generally the abstraction that you think about as a developer, they're different. Yeah?
You say that Netflix is using Apache now. But also,
so yeah, Netflix about 6 years ago when they started moving all this stuff to what they're calling Microservices now, they had a problem with scale and they were running everything in AWS on Amazon Cloud, and they, you know, a lot of the stuff like load balancing and service discovery and smart routing and all this stuff didn't really exist the way they wanted it in 2009 when they started writing it. And they solved the problem in looking at the way that they're looking at it. They're looking at it running on AWS. So all the pieces, all the libraries, all the things are sort of predicated on running this whole stuff on AWS. Now today, there's the Hystrix component, for example, that Camel uses, the ribbon component that they have, and maybe the configuration ones too. But there's a couple of components that make really good sense. But for people who are running in Docker and Kubernetes and those environments, Docker Kubernetes already solved a lot of those problems. And Docker Kubernetes are not around when Netflix started doing that stuff. So if there's parts of the Netflix stack that still are very applicable, but Netflix itself uses Camel for integration between the domain, the kind of context and stuff that I pointed out earlier. But their library is really useful in these types of environments. Hopefully that kind of explains something. Any other questions? Thank you guys for coming. Appreciate it.